1976 was the year The Clash started playing publicly in London. The year McCartney toured America for the first time in a decade. It was the year Yes played a single concert for 120,000 fans in Philadelphia. The year the band played their farewell gig in San Francisco. And the year we heard the first album from Boston. Within weeks after the release of their first album, Boston was one of the hottest new bands in America. It seemed like Tom, Brad, Barry, Fran, and Sib had become overnight sensations. But as guitarist Barry Goudreau remembers, they'd actually been at it for many years.
When Tom and I first started working together, he was going to MIT and I was going to Boston University. We rehearsed over at MIT. And we did college mixes and clubs and that sort of thing, but we never really had a whole lot of luck getting work because we were doing original songs and people weren't particularly interested in the original songs. Well, as it turns out, the demo tape that we did that eventually got us our recording contract had all those songs on it that we were trying to play in the clubs and mixers and not having much luck at it. So for us it was a pretty big surprise when the first Boston record came out and did as well as it did, because for us it had been something that we had been doing for years.
Boston, and a sound that depended heavily on the group's lead guitarist Tom Scholz. A mechanical engineer and MIT graduate, he wrote most of the songs on the album and engineered them in the basement studio of his home. More from Boston when we continue with the rock year 1976.
Thank you.
Boston, from their first album, released in 1976. Again, the group's guitarist, Barry Goudreau.
We did so well on the first record that everybody was sort of lying in wait, trying to think of reasons that it did so well, and they came up with, Tom wrote the songs on a computer, and it was all done with a synthesizer and this and that. But when it comes down to it, all it was a five-piece rock and roll band playing good songs, and you know, we had the right element of things that made it happen and go real big.
We'll be right back.
Boston's big break came only after their demo tape had been rejected by scores of record companies. The same thing had happened to another big band of 76. After a bunch of rejections, Kansas finally got some interest from Don Kirshner, who sent an associate of his, Wally Gold, out to the state of Kansas to check the band out. Phil Ehart and Dave Hope remember what they did.
Everybody thought we were country hicks, but we were pretty smart, I have to admit, as far as how we got the contract. But when he sent out Wally Gold, who produced our first two albums, and we thought, well, if this guy's coming out from New York to hear us play, what are we going to do? I mean, where are we going to have it? We just can't go to some club, because every time we played a club, there was always like 20 or 30, you know, people there out of fraternities that couldn't give a shit about what we played or what we did. We thought, we're having... So we found this hall in Ellenwood, Kansas, and put up about 400 posters with free beer. And, you know, the place was packed. I mean, there was people all the way around the block lined up to get in. So Wally pulls up and goes, wow, these guys must really be famous here, you know.
It's the famous beer.
Yeah, he didn't know it was the famous beer that was getting all the people in there. So, you know, everybody was just tanked out of their heads. Just
and he got whacked with a beer can.
Yeah, somebody threw a beer can at him.
Get the old man.
What's he doing in here? So, he, you know, we went over great. I mean, we could have just done nothing and gone over with all those drunk people. And so he was very impressed. And we got signed, and luckily, you know, we were able to pull it off. We weren't all bark and no bite.
Their first three albums were anything but a commercial success. Then in 76, they released Left Overture and had their first big smash. We'll hear it in a moment when the rock years continues. The first three albums Kansas recorded were made up of long, involved musical pieces. The band liked them, but the public was less than enthusiastic. Kansas got played on some FM stations, but not much more. And by 76, their record company was getting a bit nervous.
And you know, we started getting the, hey guys, how about a single? Mm-hmm. We went, well, what's that? You know, it's a, how about let's get some AM airplay instead of this big, broad FM airplay, which we had. We had an awful lot of FM, which allowed us to be an opening band in a lot of places. I think what propelled us into the single type of endeavor was we wanted to be a headliner. We wanted to do our own show. We were tired of doing 40 dates for Queen and 30 dates for Bad Company and Jefferson Starship and Hot Tuna and all these groups that, you know, I mean, we, after two or three years, we were just really tired of opening for other groups, and we thought, well, if we got a hit single, then we could be a headliner. So that's when Carry On Wayward Son appeared, even though it wasn't written to be a single.
We really threw that album together, we thought.
Yeah, Left Overture was kind of a, well, let's just put it together and see what happens. We had no idea it was going to have the success it did.
Carry on my wayward son, there'll be peace when you are done. Lay your weary head to rest, don't you cry no more.
Season. And if I claim to be
Kansas from their 1976 album Leftoverture. It was also the year of Rod Stewart's Night on the Town, Bowie's Station to Station, Zeppelin's Presence, Monty Python live at the City Center, and an album of Donnie and Marie Osmond featuring songs from their television show. Of course, if that wasn't hot enough for you, there was always Bad Company. Bad Company, 1976. It was the year 450,000 Americans were busted for pot, a little over 1% of the estimated 35 million who smoked it. But attitudes and laws were slowly changing, as Mississippi and Minnesota joined six other states that had drastically reduced penalties for possession. Leading the fight for decriminalization was NORML, the National Organization for the Reform of Marijuana Laws. They claimed that research showed pot was less harmful than the government was saying, and that if people had the right to smoke cigarettes and drink booze, they should also have the right to smoke pot. What's more, according to NORML spokesperson Bob Pisani, grass was a big untaxed business.
We estimated that in 1976 the market could have been worth anywhere from $15 to $20 billion a year, and that if you would have taxed that market at the rate of, say, 40%, about what they tax alcohol at, you would come up with $7, $8, $9 billion a year, which is almost twice the amount of all of the money generated from the alcohol taxes in this country. So it's very clear marijuana is a very big, influential business in this country, and our feeling is that it is high time that the marijuana industry cease to be tax exempt and that we regulate its sale and try to make some money for worthy social programs, and also allow the marijuana smoker a break from this constant paranoia of being arrested and given permanent criminal records.
On a more philosophical level, many chapters of the American Civil Liberties Union supported decriminalization. Los Angeles chapter ACLU spokesperson Ramona Ripston.
We have always believed that marijuana should be decriminalized and people should be have the right to smoke it if they want to, and people have the right to sniff cocaine if they want to. People really have the right to ingest, smoke, any kind of substance they want to use. It's an individual right. It's a personal decision. We think that it's, covered by freedom of association. We believe that. I think if you're of sound mind, you have the right to decide what it is you want to do with your own body.
But the battle was far from over, and as 1976 ended, the federal government still classified grass as a Schedule I drug with no medical benefits, along with heroin and LSD. More on 76 when the Rock Years continues. ...1976 was a big year for CBs. Even First Lady Betty Ford had one. It was the year of Convoy, and the year the Guinness Book of World Records listed the Rolling Stones as the loudest rock and roll band in the world. Almost as loud as a Concorde jet. On AM, disco was the rage. Disco Beethoven, Boogie Fever, Shake Your Booty, and Disco Duck. And believe it or not, in between the Bee Gees, Donna Summer, and Barry Manilow, top 40 stations were playing a cut that first surfaced on FM, a 14-minute track from Frampton Comes Alive.
Feel like I do.
Peter Frampton from one of the biggest selling albums of 76, Frampton Comes Alive. In a moment, another great live performer, Bob Seger, when we continue with the rock year 1976.